As governments are elected for a particular time, and governments come and go, so the often misunderstood quotation, if I may, where a public servant even identifies himself as a government servant, you are actually not a servant of the government, you are a servant of the public. And the citizen, like you said last week, it is a citizen's best interest or the country's best interest that you must put before before the political interests
I think that's very important to keep that in mind, that the government, if you call yourself a government servant, you are a servant of that particular political party,
which is for a time being
holding a position of trust until the next election.
Yes,
I think it's very important that you bear that, particularly if you are thinking of an election period. I used to think of these election periods as being a real period of truth for the public servant.
Yes.
You are in a position, if you exercise your care and do it correctly, to see that the people's will is reflected in the result.
Mm.
And that result may throw out one government and bring in another.
Mm.
And in fact, in the past, in the time when I was a civil servant,
it had happened. But you continued. That's
exactly
what we were at pains to discuss.
Yes.
Your 7 tenures under prime ministers, under 9 heads of state, despite the fact that governments change and regimes change, you continue, which is why you become the ideal guest on Checkmate. Now, Mr. Weerakoon, can I just take you to your 7 principles of public life that you refer to in one of your speeches? Perhaps this may be some guidance to those watching. You refer to 7 principles of public life that you think are implied somewhere in the establishment's code or the constitution. These are, for a public servant, selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, i.e. transparency, honesty, and leadership. You want to comment on, I know that you can't comment on everything, but comment on a few of these.
Particularly, let me take accountability and transparency, openness. You know, those are things which really are part of the public service character, that everybody is accountable. A public servant, if you look at any legislation, you find that the legislation refers to the action being done by a public servant.
Yes.
You're either the land commissioner or the government agent or a commissioner of housing or the commissioner of elections. It's not the minister.
That's right.
It's not the minister. It's not such done by the minister. It's done by a public servant. That public servant then has to carry out that, and he can become accountable. He is the accountable person. But if he's being told to do something by somebody, then he's being accountable, but actually hiding it for somebody else.
Yes, yes.
That's
making it arbitrary or unreasonable.
Arbitrary or unreasonable. And transparency also comes into the same thing. Because transparency can only be done when you're absolutely clear that what you've done is beyond any question.
Yeah.
It's open. It's an open book. I did it for these reasons. I chose so and so because he was the most qualified, not because I was told to do that by somebody else.
But what experience can you give the present public servant watching out there, who may very well want to do what you're just advocating? I mean, it sounds fine, it looks fine, it looks great. From your experience, your extensive experience of 50 years, that line, that thin line that you described, what practical advice on all these, your 7 principles of public service, can you give this public servant when push comes to shove, or when that decision must be made in favor of the public and the minister that you serve? What practical advice can you give them in making that decision?
I think you have to realize, and you have to show the minister that you are prepared, because it is his command to do it, but you want to get it in writing. You have to put those little blocks in the way. I'll do it. You can't but do it, because the man wants you to do it.
Put
it in writing, so that at least that's an accountability of why you did it. Most people, unfortunately, what happens is that after a time, the public servant is also caught in this web. He finds it more convenient to just follow the line.
Say yes,
and it's yes, minister. I would suggest that once in a way, you say no, minister. Once in a way, I mean, just to indicate, all right, you get through in this case, but not in the next. In the next case, I'm going to resign, I'm going to get out, I'm going to ask for a transfer, do something.
To establish that you are a public servant, a servant of the public.
And you're accountable. It's not that you're going to force some point. You're accountable for your actions. That's why you're there. That's why you got selected to the post. So it's very important that, At some point,
and
I know.
It's the public that pays you.
The public pays you. They pay taxes and they pay you. It's not the minister who pays you. So somehow you've got to make that point. And if you do that, you'll have a better public service, you'll have a better country, and a better government, and so on.
Yeah. Well, there you go. A very quick break we're going to right now. But these are the golden words to the public service, which I'm sure will go a long way towards the building of our new country, the new Sri Lanka, back to its pristine glory that we want to build, that we want to get to, and which Checkmate is very much on board with. So we go to a quick break, and we'll be back with you shortly. Hello and welcome back. We are in the very privileged company of Deshamanya Bradman Weerakoon, a civil servant, over 50 years of service. And we are on the last segment of what has been two programs of Checkmate and not one, because the material we had to cover was extensive. Mr. Weerakoon, can I just take you, perhaps in lighter vein, I can bring you to this question by referring to the famous BBC programs of Yes Minister and Yes Prime Minister. There was this figure, Humphrey, the civil servant, and he had been serving just like you. Perhaps he looked a bit like you. Like you. He had been serving several previous ministers and prime ministers. And Humphrey was, you know, the member of the old boys club. He dined with his fellow civil servants. And he, although at every instance he'd say, yes, minister, or yes, prime minister, and walk out, ultimately it was what Humphrey knew was public policy that was carried out, not what the minister wanted. Now, on that lighter vein, can I just bring you to this question that you addressed in your writings? You discuss this problem of the area of public policy. What is public policy? Government has become a very difficult thing to comprehend for the average person, and also very difficult for the public servant who is supposed to deliver those goods and services to the people. Now, Mr. Weerakoon, we are guided by a constitution. Mm-hmm. And in this, there are some very detailed references to state policy, how policy should be formulated. Article 27 of the constitution, that directive principles of state policy. Mm-hmm. This is what is supposed to guide all governments in the formulation of policy. Now, some of these things, like the promotion of welfare of the people, Article 27 2B, the promotion of welfare of the people by securing and protecting as effectively as it may a social order in which justice shall guide all institutions. Then 27 2E, equitable distribution amongst all citizens of the material resource of the community and the social product so as to best to subserve the common good. Then Article 27 sub-article 7, the state shall eliminate economic and social privilege and disparity and the exploitation of man by man or man by the state. Now, these are very noble principles put out in the constitution. But how much of this is filtered down to you, the public servant, who is grappling with this, like you say, the policy every day? Do they have regular classes? Are they taught regularly? What does the structure have to educate the civil servant or the public servant that this is what the citizen requires of them?
Yes, I think only a minimal education in that respect. You're expected to pick it up somewhere. But as far as the state goes, there are institutions like SLEDA, Sri Lanka Institute of Development Administration, you know, which might give you a set of lectures and so on. But I think more than anything else, how I personally benefited was from the mentoring that I had. From the older ones, the ones whom you really looked up to. So you have to have a nucleus body of people who can be those persons. And the whole process of the cadetship, for example, the civil service, it's a mentoring process. You lived with that man senior to you. You acquired his habits, you acquired his way of looking at things. And then you knew what to do instinctively. So all of this is very good, all of that from the constitution. But I would think that the first thing to be done is for the political people also to read that.
Yes.
Let them understand what they're about when they make policy.
Yes.
That
yes.
These are the kind of policies that should be made.
Yeah, but that's what I'm coming to. That's right. Speak of Humphrey. Okay, now we have a situation where to change rapidly change, the political mm-hmm. figure that is elected is another process, and that's presently not the subject of our discussion. Mm-hmm. But the civil servant, the Humphrey, knew what the policy mm-hmm. should be. So yes, there were political figures that came and went, but he would very diplomatically, not by getting into a conflict, very diplomatically, he would handle it in such a way that ultimately the policy that ought to have been formulated is formulated. How do we, with your experience at the back, how do we get Sri Lanka to at least close to that model? How do we get our public servants to one, be aware of the policy, mm-hmm. and no matter what the temporary political figures decided, these servants who are dependent upon the public purse, the public money, who are paying their salaries, how do we get it to such stage where they are knowledgeable of the policy and they implement?
I think there are two things there, yes. Certainly there is a need for more education, for more knowledge, for more discussion among groups, for more quality. There used to be quality circles, you know, all kinds of ideas came up in the past, where in a kachari or in a department, there are regular briefings. I found very useful was to have daily meetings with your heads of division, heads of staff. The different heads of department come together daily, sit with you for 15, 20 minutes and be able to then acquire from you how you felt about the whole thing. So that you were passing down something. Now, while that can go on, the Humphreys of today have to deal with very different kind of ministers than that minister who could be taken for a ride, you know, say yes and then do something else. Yes. Yeah. These ministers are much ruder now. They go right into it and they want to know exactly what happened. And they have that whole core of their own private people who are in the service too. The coordinating secretaries, this secretary, that secretary.
Who are not public servants,
who are personal servants or
politically
appointed public people. Yeah. They're paid by the public.
Government servants.
So they are the ones who just now keep nudging away and getting your public service to even get more and more caught up in this thing. So you can't get out of it. Mm. But there may be a way of releasing all of this energy that you can get through a nucleus group of public servants,
yes,
who begin to discuss among themselves. We don't have enough of that kind of lateral discussion among people. People act in watertight compartments.
Well, could Checkmate suggest to Deshamanya Bradman Weerakoon that you be a figurehead in starting such a forum? Of, I'm sure the viewer will be pleased to know that. I don't want to put you on the spot, you don't have to answer right now. But perhaps the likes of you who have experience over the years should form yourself into that body where present day public servants can just look up, ask you, talk to you, and have like I said, I don't want to put you on the spot, but perhaps that's an idea.
Yeah, it's certainly an idea. You know, India has done much better than us. In India, there are administrative clubs, and there's a whole network of people in Delhi and various other main cities where they get together and talk about these things. So there are public servants talking to other public servants, discussing their problems, newer people brought in as members or listeners or observers.
Mm.
Nothing like that here, unfortunately. We are a different kind of society.
Well, I think we'll start.
Good idea.
Okay. Then the another area, related area that I'd like to take you to is this public policy once again, but from a different angle. Various parties, not just in Sri Lanka, perhaps Asia, all over the world, put out a manifesto mm-hmm. Before they face an election. You refer to it in this way. I think the most important point here is what is different between public policy and the policy of a party. Most people who have been writing about policy, public policy, would concede that when a party comes to power, is elected popularly by the people, and has stated its manifesto, or the basis in which the people exercise their choice between one and the other, then the manifesto becomes broadly the public policy for the people. Now, my first question is, of course, this discussion has also been in the UK, so much so that several writers have in fact written that one must make a manifesto accountable in a court of law.
Mm-hmm.
There is this argument mm-hmm. that when you put out something, publish something, and you give it out to the public, the vote base, and the people vote on that, they are casting an expectation of you to carry that forward. And if it is not so, of course, the couple of test cases that they tried, they did not succeed, because the judiciary held that no, that did not come up to a binding contract, as it were. But of course, the argument is right that, that it must be accountable in some legal sense. Do you, firstly, think that people actually do vote on a manifesto? Are the people, yes, they may be able to read and write. We may have 100% or 98% literacy. But are people, from your experience of 50 years, have our people come to that stage where they actually decide on a manifesto, look at a manifesto, read a manifesto and vote? Or are we still voting along party lines?
I think we are voting all on party lines and also for people. You know, we look at personalities, that personality of that party. Sometimes even if he changes parties and goes somewhere else, they'll vote for him as a personality. So we are very much centered on the individual and not on the party. We're not certainly can always say, well, that's their manifesto to get in. And even the political people sometimes say, these are manifesto only to get in. I mean, after that, we're not going to worry about too much about the manifesto. Yeah. Manifestos are like that. They haven't got that sacredness which you imagine, which one imagines they have. But certainly, you know, not the next point that you take, the manifesto is translated into policy, which is then backed up by budgets.
That's right.
The budgetary control is the major thing which then tells you what whether your policy is going to be actually implemented or not.
Yeah.
And budgetary control is very important, and then there's the accountability of parliament. The parliament must pass it.
That's right.
But unfortunately, with massive, when you get more and more larger majorities in parliament, then budgets are not so important. The audit control is not so important. The COPE reports is...
Because you have a majority anyway.
You've got a majority anyway, and you get through it anyway.
Yes.
So you need this fairly close, you know, I don't know how you can devise that as well. But the budgetary control is also I think nullified or minimized by the fact that there are other sources of money.
Yes.
Other funds.
Extraneous of the central budget.
Extraneous of the central budget, which supplementaries and various things, which can also confuse the picture. So you're moving away from being able to strictly say that the my policy, the backed by money, and the money has to be voted by parliament and so on.
Yes. This voting by parliament, I quickly come to that, but on your manifesto aspect of it, so where does the public servant come in? Is the public servant, of course, this goes back to your early arguments, the public servant must be brave enough to say so. But does the public servant or can the public servant take up the manifesto and say to the minister or the prime minister or whoever, that's no sir, but this is what has been proclaimed on the manifesto and this policy goes against it. Is there such evaluation done by the public servant?
Some people do. I mean, some, you know, there's a lot of variation in that. There may be some person who has a good relationship with the minister and he says, you know, look, minister, it always has to be done in a negotiating way.
I mean,
not confrontational.
Yes.
And then maybe some possibilities there of a change. Sometimes it's a parliamentary opposition which can then come up and say, look, this is not what you said, then you're moving from it. So there can be an amendment to the law. There could be.
Yeah.
But I think back of all that, there must be a good media, you know. These things can't be in isolation.
To be highlighted.
We have to highlight this. The media, what the media can do in support of the public services, therefore, then the two work together. As it were. But if the media works with the political people, as very often happens, then you have a confrontation which can't be bridged.
Yeah. Can I quickly, before I allow you, we always do this to, I guess because you're selected by the production team, because of the wealth of experience you carry, and we want to allow you your 2, 3, 4 minutes to speak to that future professional of your area, to speak to them. But before I go there, the budgetary control that you spoke of, I'd like to just, if I may, cast a different angle to it. Sovereign power of the people, or the Sri Lankan, or any sovereign power of the people, because we can't go to Athens and Sparta in our history, where everyone takes a turn at the deciding policy, is now, which was earlier direct democracy or participatory democracy, has come to a representative democracy where some of us actually go to work and earn money and some of us elect some people to go and do that for us. Now, once a year, they bring a bill called the appropriation bill, which is actually how you decide on the wants that are unlimited of that country with the limited resources we have, because all of us, like in Athens and Sparta, can't be seated under olive trees and deciding policy. We send a participatory representative, an elected member, to go and decide that for us. A quick word on the public servant. When that the elected representative becomes a minister or part of the executive, and he goes and contributes to the implementation of the budget, which is actually people deciding on how best we can use our limited resources with the wants of the majority within this year. What should the public servant be aware of, be concerned of, when they send that their particular area of expenditure with their respective minister?
Yeah, I think the best, the optimum use of those, of that money, to see that there is no slippage of that money outside.
How is that checked? That's my question. Okay, you send a report, but unlike in UK, there is value for money auditing. Here it's just accountability auditing. Mm-hmm. If the bill matches the expenditure, well, that's mm-hmm. fine. But is there a check on whether it's efficiently spent, whether it's economically spent, whether it serves the purpose? How is that checked? How does a public service deal with this? I'd like your thoughts on this. How after a budget is mm-hmm. gone, after a year is gone, how does the public service check on whether what was allocated previously has been spent in the manner it was intended?
Well, there's a budgetary control which comes in by the Treasury. There are people who would be looking at you, you know. There's the Auditor General. The Auditor General has, there are internal audits and external audits, all of which work towards seeing that that money was spent appropriately, efficiently, was not overspent.
Can they check whether it was spent efficiently?
That is the difficulty, because that would depend a lot on the persons who are actually doing the job.
Yeah.
Who is the one who's supervising the contract?
Yes.
Is he getting a cut out of something,
yes,
and then is he letting it slip?
Exactly.
All kinds of slippage.
Yeah, that cannot be monitored, can it, under the present system? I mean, you will certainly check on whether it had been spent for the purpose intended.
Yes.
But beyond that,
yes,
whether you actually
properly got the,
whether the citizen got the actual
got
value for the money,
yeah.
One of the
ideas is that the public should be concerned with that as well. For example, Premadasa was a great guy on this. He would say, if you're doing a village culvert even, put up on a board the amount of money that is available for that culvert and ask the public also to watch what's going on.
Oh, I see.
And send in petitions or send in complaints that it has not been done, shoddy work has been done.
If they feel that the money,
has not been...
Yes. That's possibly a good idea.
That's an idea for the public servants to pick up.
So you tell the public exactly how much money is going to be used on this project,
yeah,
so that if the public had a complaint,
yeah,
they can immediately...
That's it, yeah.
Good. Well, here is your little occasion. Not little. You can take as much as... perhaps you'd like to... I'd like to bring you to it by speaking of your four freedoms that you speak of. You speak of the four freedoms of ignorance, of disease, from want and fear. And you say that these... If these four fears are overcome, then it'll be a healthy society in all angles. What is Deshamanya Bradman Weerakoon's message to the public servant watching out there, the future Sri Lankan, who will take on the mantle of the civil service, who will take our duties to serve us? What's your message to them?
Well, let me start like this. When I was 18 years old, I listened to this fabulous speech that Mr. Bandaranaike made at Independence. The first Independence Day. That's where the four freedoms came in.
Mm.
He said, this freedom we are talking about will be just a mere, you know, rhetorical thing without meaning until we achieve those four freedoms. Freedom from ignorance for our people, freedom from disease, so that nobody is diseased as long as you can possibly cure it or prevent it. Nobody is in want and nobody is in fear. Now, those are enormous things. They're very simple words, but the profoundness of it is terrific. I mean, if the public servant can also regard himself as being the bearer of this tradition of giving freedom, to empowering people to be not ignorant, not with disease, not with want, not with fear, and somehow in association with, of course, the political people, you can't do it alone. That could be the way in which we could go to this better Lanka that we're looking at. I've been measuring for 60 years, actually, every year, how have we done. If I'm asked for an Independence Day message of my own, I always say, okay, let's try and see how far we've got. On ignorance, we've got literacy and so and so. But there are many things that you referred to too, in which we are quite ignorant. Our people are not knowledgeable about so many things. On disease, we've conquered disease to some extent, but there's yet another emerging diseases coming, HIV, AIDS, all kinds of things. Want, we say we are population, the poverty rate is down to 9%, but we know that there are millions of people who are on samruddhi. There may be 7 million people, I think, who families on some of the, how does that coincide with this 9% poverty thing? And how do you account for it? And fear, we got rid of terrorism, okay. But then are we less fearful now of anything? Are we living in a fearless society? I think ask those questions continually, agitate with those questions in your mind. Don't agitate on the street, agitate those questions in your mind. Yes. And say, how can you contribute in your little way? Because little drops are the things that make this.
That make the big stream.
Yeah. How do you do that?
Mr. Weerakoon, it's been an absolute pleasure and privilege, sir, to have you at our studios. You've sat very patiently with us over two programs, not one. You've shared the wealth of your accumulated experience with us. And to that, not just us at Rupavahini, I'm sure the entire country watching is grateful. Thank you for the wonderful service you've rendered unto Caesar and unto the citizen of this country. We take great pride in your presence, in the fact that you came and accommodated us in your very busy schedule. And I thank you, not just on behalf of the production team and Rupavahini, but I take your cue and I thank you on behalf of all our viewers as well. Sri Lanka says thank you. We say thank you. Aibon, sir.
Aibon. Thank you very much. That's great.
Well, we've come to the end of another checkmate. Lives of ordinary people on an extraordinary journey. With the hope of seeing you again on another one of our programs, I'm about to bid you adieu. But I do so with these words from H.W. Longfellow. This is for you, future Sri Lanka. Heights by great men, reached and kept, were not attained by sudden flight. For they, whilst their companions slept, were toiling upwards in the night. The future of Sri Lanka is with you, our youth, our generations to come. Sri Lanka, go for it.